Is that it?
No, I didn't hear particular accusation.
Well, get on with it.
What about your... Aren't you a little afraid you're going to singe
your hair? If I was afraid, I wouldn't do it.
You wouldn't do it. Then. You actually cut your own hair.
Yeah.
How? Why?
I operated on my own appendix yesterday.
Why do you cut your own hair?
I don't like to go to a barber.
You designed this hairstyle?
I didn't design it, I just cut it.
You've been doing this all your life?
What do you want from me?
I'm just curious. Not you're supposed to go to the barber, but...
Do you go to the barber?
Yeah.
When's the last time?
Oh, a couple of weeks ago, as a matter of fact.
Wasn't he in?
Well, how'd you get into cutting your own hair? I'm just curious about this. I mean,
just cut it. I got a crew cut on top, and I trim it, and I trim the back a little, and that's it. You want to hear about... I have a fetish for sneakers. You want to hear that story?
Yeah, let's hear that one.
I'm not interested in talking about it.
Heard any good jokes recently?
Yeah.
Want to tell one?
Come to the Sahara and you'll see.
You're not a real joke teller, though, right?
Not per se, no.
No. Who are the people who influenced you when you were very young? Your mother played the piano and she performed. Your father was an all-around entertainer.
You bet. The best. What? He was the greatest influence.
What did you do with your mother and father on stage?
I did sketches with my dad when I was 7, 8, 9 years old. I was playing 60-year-old men in makeups and wigs when I was like 9 and 10 years old. My dad worked with a couple of marvelous people, Jimmy Gerard, Lou Black, and I would learn from them. And my dad was very heavy-handed in the teaching process. He had no time for nonsense. He knew I was qualified or not, and I learned from him.
How did he respond to your very, very quick success and what you did with Dean when it really started to take off? What were some of the things he said to you about your shtick and the stuff you were
doing? He was always very critical because he cared. He used to say to me, you got enough people around you telling you how wonderful you are, you need a few more like me telling you that...
What sort of things would you remember he would say? I mean, this is the voice of...
His greatest quote was, you dogged it. And he was right. If I didn't give 108% of energy, I was dogging it. And I'd say, Dad, I just did 8 shows today and we got one more tonight at the Paramount. I said, I think I did dog the last one, but I'm whipped. He said, then don't go on, my friend. Get sick, but don't dog it.
Yeah. Did he like the premise, the basic Martin and
Lewis
premise?
Oh, yes, very much so.
Why do you think that there has not really been a successful film comedy team since you and Dean?
Because it's very difficult.
Yeah. I think maybe Richard Pryor and Gene Wilder could do it.
Well, no, not based on what you're remembering. I think you can set up two wonderful...
They're two actors writing.
Well,
what's
great.
The difference between two actors playing, say, doing a series of 5 or 6 movies and a comedy team? I'm talking about cinematics.
Okay. The difference is that in the cinema structure, you don't have to have Walter Matthau and Jack Lemmon deeply concerned one for another, because the Neil Simon material works.
Gives them what, yeah.
I mean, you can use any one of 1,000 dancers in this town tonight to go on Chorus Line, and they're hardly going to affect it one way or another, because it's so structured, it's so magnificent. Not only the music, but everything about it. You can't hurt the Rock of Gibraltar, you know. I don't know how else to put it. And when you have Walter Matthau and Jack Lemmon doing a Neil Simon play, The Odd Couple, there's nothing they can do to damage it. They don't have to care one for another on a sensitive emotional level. Just do the work, and they're professionals.
Yeah.
The best that there is, they're gonna do it. Dean and I didn't have that kind of work to enhance our values. We had so much stronger than any Neil Simon play. Neil cannot write the love of two men on paper and have it work. You can perform it, but you can't have that happen. It was a magical Damon and Pythias miracle, and that was the key. The star of Martin and Lewis's galaxy was their relationship, not their ability. And that's why people would always say, I saw Dean and Jerry at the Copa. One guy says, I didn't, what did they do? And the guy says, well, what do they do? Well, you gotta go. And that was it all the time. Whereas you wanna tell me what Streisand does, you can. You can tell me what Richard Pryor does, you can. You can tell me about Chorus Line, you can. But to this day, no one could ever tell anyone what Martin and Lewis had that made it work.
affection.
Deep.
A black and white sort of thing, a polarity between the two, as you described it before.
He had 100 marvelous tools at his command, many of which he wasn't aware of, and the same with me. And they meshed, but all of the meshing wouldn't have meant a hill of beans if the little guy didn't look at his hero the way he did, and if the hero didn't protect the little guy as he did. You can't have that happen unless it's real. And when that was impaired, there was no survival.
It could no longer be real.
No way. I mean, I had an attorney look at me and say, are you telling me you can't look in his eyes on a stage for 6 more months and pick up over $30 million in this deal? And I looked at him and I said, you haven't heard everything I said. Yeah. Integrity is nowhere near the same word that can be used with money. Now, I'm going to say it to you once more. There's a principle here, and there are values that make me an individual of some worth. That's only going to make me richer. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be what I have to be to get that. That was the key.
Well put. We have to pause again.
What are we selling now?
I don't know.
Oh, I know.
We'll
Mrs. Smith's pies. And you can get to
That's from Jerry Lewis' new film, Hardly Working. Where did the Japanese character come from?
Tokyo.
No kidding.
First time I went to Tokyo, it's just such fun, and they have such fun at the fun you make of them, that I just fell in love with it. It's fun to do. You know, the sounds are what gets me crazy. I fall in love with sounds. They're like, hello. How can you not love that? You know, plus the fact it's very, very good if you're, it's marvelous. I love it.
But you have any, do you understand Japanese at all, or just totally into what the sounds like?
Not really.
You must have read the autobiography of Charles Chaplin, right?
Yes, a number of times.
I would think, just assuming that you did that. What kind of an impact did that have on you?
Well, I learned more from knowing Charlie Chaplin and being with him than the autobiography. Had I not known him at all, I don't know. See, I couldn't say.
How much time did you spend with Charlie Chaplin?
Well, we met in Los Angeles and we spent a couple of nights together, and then I made it a point to visit him at his home in Switzerland twice a year, once a year, whenever I could. And we had some very meaningful times together. And I learned a great deal. And he was a good friend. And I was so awestruck, I mean literally awestruck, that this mouth that you've just had for all this time was totally inarticulate, incapable of really communicating, and I was having a tough time because the awestruck never left me. Yeah. In all the time I knew him. And there was nothing I can do about that.
Would you say that if you had not met Charlie Chaplin and gotten to know him as a friend and not pondered over his book, his autobiography, that maybe you wouldn't be doing exactly what you're doing today? I guess I'm trying to find out how much he contributed to your life.
Oh, I don't know that he did, really.
No?
No. My respect for him... Well, it's my respect for Marvin. Marvin is a friend of ours. I think
Marvin Hamlisch. Marvin is here in the studio today. That's why we.
I've said it to him, said it to his face. I don't want to embarrass him, but the magic of his talent and the love within the man, matched with his ability, is what makes Marvin Hamlisch. That was Chaplin. But what I'm getting at is that my knowing Marvin as a friend has not changed my life in any way. Mm-hmm. It's enriched it slightly. But the influence of knowing Marvin, because of his magic and his talent and his ability, and I'm in awe of that great talent, it hasn't changed my life. So
go ahead.
Knowing Charlie Chaplin and being with him was only that wonderful feeling of being so special to be in his presence. Like yesterday, I was with the President of the United States, and to stand in the Oval Office and spend 30, 40 minutes with an old friend who's now the President is awesome.
You felt different. You had to, right?
You feel different. I'm with the President of the United States, every nine-year-old's hero of the world.
What did you call him?
Mr. President. Absolutely. Now, when I spent time with Jack Kennedy, it was always Jack, but never when anyone was around. Now, I'm sure it'll be Ronnie when Ronnie and I are together alone. But
when you're alone.
You have to respect that office. Mm. And I never want to give up awe. I think I would die if I was no longer impressionable. If I told you how I responded to meeting John Wayne the first time, you'd think I was a liar, because it's childlike, it's fantasy-like.
Who are some of the other people today, if we brought them out here in the studio? You would be the nine-year-old, and you would be in awe. Some.
All talented people, all creative people that create for the reason that creation was made, that care about their work, that are respectful of their contribution to the betterment of mankind. I'm in awe of all those
people. What happens to your ego when you're, we all have egos, right? What happens to your ego when you're with somebody like that? Is there a part of you that's competitive at all?
No.
Not at all?
When I'm with those kind of people, I don't have any.
What about other funny people? Other
comedians? They're very humbling. When you're with great comic people, it's humbling. You're very humbled by it. It's not a contest. I could never do that. It isn't a contest. I do what I do, and I'm the only one who does that. He does what he does, and he's the only one who does that. My ego works for me on a more productive level. I never allow it, or at least I'm not aware consciously. I mean, if you can be in awe or inspired by someone's presence, I don't think ego can participate in that feeling.
Right.
Okay? And it's good to be that way. And I don't care how important you get in this life, there's always somebody that's going to diminish you by their presence. And if you don't recognize it,
right,
acknowledge it,
very important,
and say, damn it, I'm going to be like that sometime too, you'll never have a shot at growing.
Give me an example of project yourself into the 80s. What do you want to be like too? What would you like your life to be like 5, 10 years down the line?
I don't care. I really don't.
But you have to care. Doesn't that direct you? I mean, have to have a direction.
Tomorrow is my target. Only tomorrow.
We must have some goals.
Yeah. My greatest goal is to awaken tomorrow. When I awaken, I will be the biggest hit of all time.
To yourself, right?
That's it. And if you think beyond that, you're playing foolish games.
What about the structure of your life? You move from Los Angeles to Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
The way you want to spend your tomorrows, the way you want to spend your time, your priorities, your plans. You have to have some specific sense. Obviously, you want the telethon to keep going.
I want to do all good stuff. And if I can jam it all in tomorrow, it'll be terrific. If I can't, hopefully it'll be September.
How's your back?
It's okay.
Is it?
It's all right.
I know when we met, really had the conversation out in Las Vegas, when I saw you last year, I was quite taken by it. I never really had any insight into how much pain you had as a result of that injury.
Everybody that has a spinal injury has terrible problems, but I'm beating it here, and it's working.
Have you tried self-hypnosis at all?
No.
See, when you move to New York, we have this wonderful self-hypnosis clinic here. We will take care of all your problems.
Mm-hmm. You know, you're really a nuisance. Billy Boggs.
You know what's weird is, doing a talk show, interview people about all different things. And one of the things, since in being an interviewer, I've really come to believe, and it's just what you said, that you can have a physical problem, but you got to lick it up here. And that's why I mentioned that. Self-hypnosis is not so much really going to a clinic. That's a joke. I don't even know of a clinic in New York. What I meant simply was that concept of beating something mentally is...
Yes, you can say, I think that the mind is the greatest one tool that we come on Earth with. And it's unfortunately not utilized as much as it can be. But when you put it to work, it can do anything. You can really do anything. Because I'm not having any less pain today than I've had for the last 15 years with this damn thing. But I'm able to deal with it better because I'm using this as opposed to some years ago when I didn't use that and I used medication.
Medication.
And that's wrong.
So you gotta feel tremendous. You have to feel better in general not taking medication.
I not only feel better, but you have a greater feeling of, again, self-worth, that you were able to bite the bullet.
Yeah.
And you have to.
Sure.
You really do.
Here we go again. What's it going to be this time?
Oh, I know. Wendley ties.
Wendley ties.
Would you check on it?
Fine tie.
Yeah, made in Taiwan by this Jewish. Things, and it's not always that.
Jerry Lewis has been the guest for this entire show, and there's one thing I'd like to ask: how is the family?
Good.
What are the guys doing?
My guys?
Yeah, your guys.
Well, I got one guy with me, and he's an electronic wizard. I've got a couple of boys of my assistant directors in production, one production manager. They're all doing fine.
Oh, that's good. Jerry, I wish you good health.
Thank
first,
you.
You know, particularly with the back injury.
Thank
and
you.
I wish you real success with Hardly Working. I think that it's just great to laugh, and it would be wonderful to have a big Jerry Lewis hit again.
We're going to have a lot of them.
It would be nice. And the thing with De Niro and Scorsese, I think, is for any Jerry Lewis fan or anyone who has seen Jerry Lewis' talent, regardless of any controversy swirling around you, I think that those people really respect you, want you to do that. They want to see you just go one-on-one with the greats.
I picked a doozy, didn't I, to go one-on-one with De Niro.
That's going
to
be
good. I'm no fool.
So I thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill.
Good luck. Safe journey.
Thank you. Same to you. If you're going anywhere, if you're smart, move out of New York.
Have a nice afternoon. Thank you.